Welcome to the ninth lecture of electric power system, where we are going to discuss the transmission line modeling. We have discussed that power is being transmitted from the generating station to the consumer end, traveling through a long distance. So generally the power is being transmitted through overhead transmission line. So power is being transmitted through overhead transmission line, and in this chapter we will be dealing with the modeling part of the overhead transmission line in terms of the electrical modeling. So we are going to perform the electrical modeling of overhead transmission line. So that is the prime motive of this chapter. So here we can see that when you have the voltage for different levels, suppose you are having a 275 kV and 132 kV or 66 kV transmission lines, then the length of the tower, the length of tower varies. Now these towers are also of various shapes. So you can see that this is one sided tower, whereas these are both sided towers. So towers can be of various shapes. As well as its height depend upon what voltage level we are taking. So here is a typical tower which is shown in the figure. We will try to identify the important elements here. So in this you can see that these are the conductors which are running through the tower, and between the conductors in different part you have the insulators. At the top you will find a earth wire which is helpful in case of lightning. So if there is a lightning, then what will happen? The electric power will flow through this wire to the ground, which is earthed. And insulators are there which segregate two parts of the transmission line. So here you can see that there is a porcelain insulator which is being used for this transmission line. So in this transmission line you can see that particular disc of a porcelain insulator represents 11 kV. So if there are n number of insulators, n disc, then you can multiply n into 11, that will give you the transmission level voltage. So this is basically the earth wire, and all the conductors are running, which are not very straight but little bit bent. There are different other items which are used to prevent the any type of faults in the transmission line. Like we have spacers. Spacers are used to keep the two transmission line at a distance. Then you can have a damper. These dampers are used when you have a heavy wind. So when heavy wind is blowing, generally the dampers avoid the swinging of the conductor. Then you have something called as cross arms. This helps to protect the conductor to be in touch when there is certain bend in the conductor. Then this is known as the tower, which represents a steel tower. The tower can be of various material. It can be wooden tower, it can be concrete tower, it can be steel tower. Okay, then these are the insulators which prevent the conductors from any other elements touching each other. The earth wire always flows at the top of the tower. Generally, the conductors are not straight, but it is little bit bent. So the conductors are not straight. It is hanging. This is known as sag. So the distance with which the conductor bends from the straight line is known as sag. So the conductor is bent through a distance from the straight line. This is known as sag. And the distance of the conductor from the ground is known as the clearance. So clearance is the distance of the conductor from the ground. The distance between the two tower is known as span. Distance between the two tower is known as span. So here we can see one more device which is known as arcing horn. So generally what happens when the air around the conductor is magnetized due to the high magnetic field. So you have the arcing horn which is present to prevent the magnetization of the air. Okay, you here you can see that there is a damper and spacer connected between the conductors to prevent the conductor from touching each other. So here you can have one face of the conductor. So it is one face of the conductor which is given with a insulator. So insulator here it is shown as composite insulator. So earlier we have seen the porcelain insulator, here we have composite insulator. And we have something known as line arrestors, which are also used for high voltage prevention apparatus. High voltage prevention apparatus. The transmission tower and the components which are associated with it are so many that increase the complexity as well as cost of the conductor. So the complexity and the cost both increases for transmission of power due to the presence of so many apparatus which are required for a transmission of the power. So here you can see that there are a lot of apparatus which are connected with a transmission tower for efficiently transmitting the power. That is why the power systems are very complex and it is the most costly for transmitting the power. Now in this particular chapter we are going to study the parameters of the transmission line. We will study the relation of parameters with electric and magnetic field. Then we will see what are the types of conductors used for transmission of the power. Then resistance of the transmission line and variation with temperature. So the first parameter we will start with is resistance. So resistance of the transmission line will be described and its variation with temperature will be described. And then the final thing we will have what is skin effect and its consequences. So these are the contents that we are going to cover in our lecture number 9. So let us start with that. The parameters of the transmission line. Then electrical transmission line has basically four parameters. So any transmission line modeling can be done if we know four parameters. The first parameter is the resistance and second parameter is the inductance. These resistance and inductance form the series impedance. So inductance and resistance form the series impedance. The third parameter is the capacitance and the fourth parameter is the conductance which forms the shunt admittance. So you can have a capacitance and a conductance and this forms the shunt admittance. Okay, so the four parameters that govern any transmission lines are the resistance, inductance, capacitance and conductance. So these are the four parameters of any transmission line. Let us first start with the fourth parameter, conductance. So conductance exists between conductors or conductor and the ground. So if there are two conductors or a conductor and a ground, then there exists a conductance. So between two conductors L1 and L2, or between a conductor L1 and the earth or the ground, the conductance presents. Now it accounts for the leakage current. So conductance is associated with the leakage current at the insulator of overhead lines and through insulation of cables. So both overhead transmission line and underground cables, we will have the leakage current which is there, that give rise to the conductance. Now leakage at insulators of overhead lines is negligible. Conductance is neglected. So generally the power is transmitted through overhead transmission line, and in overhead transmission line the leakage is negligible. So leakage is negligible at insulators. So we will neglect the conductance effect in overhead transmission line. That is what we have variable no good way to take into account. It is not easy to measure the leakage current, which is very minute in case of overhead transmission line. So we will not take the conductance into picture. Leakage at insulator change appreciably with atmospheric condition. So whenever there is a rain or snow or any other change in the environmental condition, this leakage of current at the insulator is changing, which is not easy to measure. That's the result we do not take conductance into account. Conducting properties due to dirt deposit on insulator. So whenever you have certain insulators, so if you have certain insulator and if there are some moisture or dirt present, then these insulating material become the conducting properties. It is showing the conducting properties due to which some amount of current, which is known as the leakage current, flows through it. This give rise to the conductance. Generally, the corona variables are there with atmospheric condition. So there is something which is known as corona effect, which we are going to describe and study in detail. However, now I am going to tell you the corona is basically due to the high voltage that is flowing through the conductor. The air around it is magnetized, due to which there is a hissing noise and some glow in the conductor, which is known as corona. So the corona generally changes with the atmospheric conditions. So effect of conductance is negligible amount of shunt admittance. So here when you have the shunt admittance, you hear the presence of conductance is very negligible in overhead transmission line. So we neglect it, and only capacitance take place in case of shunt admittance. Now let us deal with what is the relation of parameters with electric and magnetic field. So we have seen there is a resistance, inductance, which makes to be the series impedance, and then there is a capacitance which include the shunt admittance. So these three parameters are the one which we are going to study one by one for modeling of the transmission line. So in order to modeling of transmission line, we should know the resistance, inductance and capacitance of a transmission line. We know that whenever there is an alternating current, then this alternating current is associated with both electric field as well as magnetic field. This means that the parameters inductance and capacitance as well as something also resistance. We will see that there is an AC resistance and there is a DC resistance. So this AC resistance, inductance and capacitance are governed by the electric field and the magnetic field. So let us consider a conductor and form a group. So the lines of magnetic flux, so there will be a magnetic flux lines and electric flux lines due to the AC current. So you have an alternating current due to which there will be lines of magnetic flux which will form a closed loop. Lines of magnetic flux will form a closed loop linking the conductor. So here you have a conductor which is one is going the current, another is the return conductor. So if the conductors are separated by a distance d and the diameter is small d, so small d is the diameter of the conductor and the capital D is the spacing between the conductors. So the diameter of the conductor is very small as compared to the spacing. Now the magnetic flux lines will form a closed loop. Magnetic flux lines will form a closed loop. So these are the magnetic flux lines which form a closed loop linking the circuit. So magnetic flux lines will form a closed loop linking the circuit. Lines of electric flux. So we have studied the magnetic flux. Now we'll study the electric flux lines. Electric flux lines will originate from the positive charge. Electric flux lines will originate from the positive charge, that is from one conductor, and terminate on the negative charge on the other conductor. So electric flux lines will originate from the one charge, that is positive, and terminate in the negative charge of the conductor. So here in this figure you can see that H represent the magnetic flux lines which forms a closed loop, and E represent the electric flux lines which originate from the positive charge and then terminate at the negative charge. So I positive and I negative. So electric flux lines are shown in this way and the magnetic flux lines are shown by a closed loop. Variation of the current. So when you have an AC current, right? So there will be a variation of the current which causes a change in the number of magnetic flux lines linking the circuit. So whenever there is a variation in the current, then the number of magnetic flux lines linking the circuit changes. When there is a change in the flux linkage, it induces a voltage proportional to the rate of change of the flux. So we know that from Faraday's law, d phi by dt, that is the rate of change of the proportional of the flux, is directly proportional to the induced EMF, This is the Faraday's law. So there is a change in the flux whenever there is a variation in the current. If there is a variation in the current, then magnetic flux lines linking the circuit will change. There will be change in the flux. If there is a change in the flux, a voltage proportional to which will be induced. This means that the inductance gives rise to the voltage induced, and there is a changing flux due to the rate of the change of the current. So inductance, the property of a transmission line, is due to the magnetic flux associated with the transmission line. So whenever there is a magnetic flux, and this magnetic flux is due to the changing in the current or the AC current, So if there is an alternating current, there will be a flux, and this flux will give rise to an inductance. Similarly, the capacitance property is due to the electric field lines. So charge on the conductor per unit of potential difference between them. So you can define the capacitance as the charge on the conductor per unit of potential difference. So wherever there is electric field, there will be a capacitance. So this Q indicates the charge and V indicates the potential, and there will be an electric field. So electric field lines originate from the positive charge and terminate in the negative charge. So that will give rise to the capacitance. Now, what are the types of the conductors that are used in the transmission line? So earlier, copper was used for transmitting the power, which is replaced with aluminium. So nowadays, aluminium is used for transmitting the power. Why? What is the reason that aluminium has been replaced the copper? It is of much lower cost. So the prime importance is aluminium is cheaper than copper, lightweight for the same resistance, lighter weight you have for the aluminium for the same resistance. Now, aluminium conductor has larger diameter. Aluminium conductor has larger diameter compared to the copper for the same resistance. So if you keep the resistance constant, then the aluminium conductor diameter, will be more as compared to copper. And this is quite advantageous, that we will see what advantage it will give when the diameter increases. So if the diameter of the conductor increased, then there are certain advantages due to which the aluminium is preferred over copper. The other factors being the cost and the lighter weight. So the lines of electric flux that is originating on the conductor will be further apart at the conductor surface for the same voltage. So lines of electric flux, you have seen that electric flux lines originate from the positive charge and terminate at the negative charge, will be further apart when there is a voltage. So this voltage plays a very important role in governing this electric flux lines. Now, lower voltage gradient at the conductor surface. So whenever you take a conductor and you deal with the surface of the conductor, then the voltage gradient, that is delta V, voltage gradient is lower. So less tendency to ionize the air around the conductor. That is known as corona. We have described that corona is the property by which there is a ionization of the air due to the high voltage in the wire. So, due to the lower voltage gradient at the conductor surface, there is a less tendency to ionize the air. Now, we'll describe how many types of aluminium conductors are there. So, first conductor that we are going to discuss is AAC, all aluminium conductor. Second, AAAC, all aluminium alloy conductors. Then ACSR, aluminium conductor steel reinforced, and ACAR, aluminium conductor alloy reinforced. So these are the various variants of aluminium conductor. However, aluminium conductor steel reinforced are generally more used as compared to the other. So aluminium alloy conductors have higher tensile strength. So you can see that the types of aluminium conductor that has been described are basically the alloys, of aluminium, which give a higher tensile strength as compared to the ordinary conductor. So we do not use only aluminium, rather that we use aluminium alloy, okay, because it will give you the higher tensile strength. Now ACSR, as I said to you, aluminium conductor steel reinforced are generally used nowadays. So aluminium conductor steel reinforced is basically central core of steel, means at the center you will get a steel strand. So at the center you will get steel strands, and then it is surrounded by a layers of aluminium strand. and it will be surrounded with layers of aluminium strand. Aluminium conductor steel reinforced, where steel is at the center and it is surrounded with aluminium strands. Aluminium conductor alloy reinforced, where center core of higher strength aluminium is surrounded by layers of electrical conductor grade aluminium. So aluminium ACSR and ACAR conductors are generally more used. However, ACSR is given the prime importance. Here you have higher strength aluminium which is formed at the center. So here you can see that aluminium higher strength will form the core. Here steel will form the core. Here aluminium will be surrounded with the strands. Here electrical conductor grade aluminium will be surrounded. Now, what are stranded conductors? What are stranded conductors? So here we can see one picture for stranded conductors which are used in transmission of power. So nowadays you will see that whenever there is a transmission of power in the transmission line, we use stranded conductor. So here, how the definition? Alternate layers of wires are spiraled. So here you can see that it is spiraled and in the opposite direction. So it is spiraled in the opposite direction. So this is spiraled here and this is spiraled here. To prevent unwinding so that it doesn't open up. Okay, and here you can see that there are 7 conductors of steel. So this blue color, this blue color is basically shown as steel, and this color is shown as aluminium. So there are 2 layers. So this is the first layer of aluminium, and this is the second layer of the aluminium. And here you have steel as the strand core. So there are 7 conductors of steel which is formed the central end, and 2 layers of 30 conductors of aluminium. So these are aluminium conductor steel reinforced. Okay. Outer radius of one layer coincide with inner radius of the next layer. So here you can see that in this photo, this is the first layer and this is the second layer. So outer radius of one layer coincide with the inner radius of the next layer. It provides flexibility for large cross-sectional area. So cross-sectional area will increase. Cross-sectional area will increase with the use of ACSR conductor. Number of strands depends on the number of layers. How many number of layers you are using, that will govern that how many strands you are using, whether all the strands are of same diameter or not. So it depends like how many layers has to be used. Now after ACSR, there is something called expanded ACSR. So expanded ACSR has fillers such as paper separating the inner steel strand from the outer aluminium strand. So in the inner you have steel, in the inner you have steel, and in the outer layer you have aluminium. So between the steel and aluminium, it is a paper is present which separates and act as a filler. Paper gives larger diameter, so the corona will reduce. Now here one important point to remember at the here is when the diameter of the conductor increase, as I says that diameter increase is good. So when the diameter of the conductor increase, the corona will reduce for a given conductivity and tensile strength. Now we will discuss the first parameter, that is the resistance of the transmission line. Till now we have discussed what are the types of the conductors that is used for power transmission, how many parameters are there which we'll be using for modeling, why we neglect conductance in overhead transmission lines. So the first parameter that we are going to discuss is resistance. So resistance is responsible for power loss in the transmission line. So you know that power loss is basically equal to I square into R. So this resistance is responsible for the power loss. Now here, effective resistance of the conductor can be found out by this formula. Since power is equal to I square R, now I need to find what is the resistance of the conductor R. So it is equal to the power loss. So it is equal to the power loss divided by the magnitude of the current square ohms. So this is basically the effective resistance. Now this effective resistance is known as the DC resistance. This is known as the DC resistance for uniform current distribution. So in case of DC, there will be a uniform current distribution, and this formula can be used to find out the DC resistance of the conductor. AC resistance is a little bit different. Now the DC resistance is given by R0 is equal to rho L by A. This is from the material property. So R is equal to rho L by A, where rho is the resistivity, L is the length of the conductor, and A is the area of the cross section of the conductor. This is known as the DC resistance. Now DC resistance of stranded conductor is greater than computed by R0. So the formula that we are using to compute the resistance will not give you the accurate result for the stranded conductor, because there will be spiraling. We have seen that in ACSR conductor, stranded conductor, we have spiraling of the conductors, due to which strands make them longer than the conductor itself. This is the reason the resistance formula will give you less value as compared to the actual resistance of the stranded conductor. So it is 1% for three strands. So suppose you are using three strands stranded conductor, then there will be a reduction of the resistance calculation as 1%. If you have concentrically stranded conductor, then there is a reduction of 2%. Now we'll discuss the what is the impact of temperature on the variation of resistance, how the temperature vary the resistance. So generally we have seen that we have used the formula R is equal to rho L by A, and we know from Ohm's law V is equal to IR, keeping the temperature constant. So we say that keeping the temperature constant. However, this resistance or the resistivity of the material varies with temperature, which is generally neglected. But if we take into account, let us see. So practically it is linear over the normal range of operation. So if you draw a curve between a resistance on the y-axis and temperature on the x-axis, then you will get a practically linear curve. Okay, this curve is little bit extended to the linear portion. So if you extend it here, so it is little bit non-linear in the initial part, and then it become linear. So it is extended so that the resistance make it to be zero at some amount of temperature. So the correction of the resistance has to be there with temperature. This correction of resistance can be done finding the point of intersection of the temperature axis with zero resistance. So whenever there is a zero resistance, how much there is the resistance in the conductor. So you can use the formula R2 by R1 is equal to T0 plus T2 by T1. So in this case, T at a temperature T1, the resistance will be R1. At a temperature T2, the resistance will be R2. So this T0, which is the initial temperature, can be easily found out. So uniform distribution of current through A occurs only for DC. So when you have the cross-sectional area of the conductor, so if this is a cross-sectional area of the conductor, then uniform distribution of the current. So there will be uniform distribution of the current. This occurs only for DC, only for DC. But for AC, as the frequency increases, there is a non-uniformity becomes more pronounced. So the current which was uniform has become non-uniform when you are dealing with the AC and frequency is increased. Then there is a property known as skin effect, which we are going to study. So the non-uniform distribution of electric current over the surface or skin of the conductor carrying AC current is known as skin effect. So this is the definition of skin effect. So what is the definition? Whenever you have an AC current flowing, then there will be non-uniform distribution of electric current, and this current will be flowing through the outer surface of the conductor, which is known as the skin of the conductor. This is known as the skin effect. Other words, the concentration of charge is more near the surface as compared to the core of the conductor. So if you have, this is the core of the conductor. So as we move from the core to the outer surface, the concentration will be more on the outer surface rather than the core. So the ohmic resistance of the conductor is increased. Now if you see the resistance for an AC is increased due to the current on the surface of the conductor. So ohmic resistance of AC will be more than ohmic resistance of the DC. So skin effect is the increase in frequency caused the non-uniform current distribution. So whenever there is an AC, due to the increase in frequency, there is non-uniform distribution of the current. Now if the conductor is circular, current density usually increases from the interior towards the surface. Now considering that the conductor is circular in nature, so current density usually increases from the interior towards the surface. So larger radius conductor current density is oscillatory with respect to radial distance from the center. So if your radius is larger or diameter is larger, larger radius, current density will become oscillatory from the radial distance to the center. Now here one formula has been given, RAC is equal to RDC into K under root F. So F is basically the frequency of operation which is taken in megahertz range. So frequency is taken in megahertz. And this K is the property of the conductor which is known as wire gauge factor K. So if we have calculated the DC resistance which is as 0 Hertz, so at 0 Hertz there is a DC resistance if you have calculated, then with respect to frequency we can see that the AC resistance will be very very more than the DC resistance. So AC resistance will be quite more than the DC resistance. Now here one typical table shows the K factor, that is the wire gauge factor, with respect to the gauge size. So as the gauge size increases, so it is 4/0, 2/0, 1/0, you can see this is the gauge size of the conductor. So here the K factor is eventually changing, and due to the change of this K factor with the frequency, the AC resistance will change. So here let us take one example to understand the variation of AC with DC. Now consider that the DC resistance is 25 ohms, and the value of K that has been taken from the table is 27.6. Then at a frequency of 10 megahertz, you are getting an AC resistance in the range of kilo ohms, which was in ohms. For DC resistance, you are getting kilo ohms for AC. That means that the AC resistance is quite high as compared to the DC resistance. So you can understand that if there is a skin effect, due to the skin effect, the AC resistance will be quite high as compared to the DC resistance. So what are the factors that affect the skin effect? What are the major factors that affect the skin effect apart from the frequency? So apart from frequency, what are the factors? Let us see. Okay. So here we know one of the factors is frequency. So as frequency will increase, your skin effect will increase. Next factor is diameter increases with the increase in diameter of the conductor. So diameter will increase, skin effect will increase, shape of the conductor. So solid conductor when it has, then it is more, DC skin effect is more for solid conductor and less for standard conductor. That is the reason we are preferably using aluminium conductor steel reinforced, as one of the important advantage is that the skin effect will be lower in this ACSR conductor, because the surface area of the solid conductor is more as compared to the ACSR. And it also depends upon the type of the material, because the material type is governed by the permeability of the material. So increase with the increase in the permeability of the material. So as the permeability increase, the skin effect increase. So here in this picture, you can see that when a DC current is flowing, that entire cross-sectional area is used for the flow of the current. When you are using an AC under two different frequency range, when the frequency is low, when frequency is low or when frequency is high. So when frequency is low, you can see that certain amount of the charge is present inside also. But as frequency increases, the charge is moving from the inside and residing over the skin of the conductor. This is known as skin effect. So primarily this frequency is the very governing factor, and the diameter is also the second importance factor. The shape and type of the material also governs the skin effect. So this completes the lecture number 9, where we have discussed the transmission line modeling. In the next lecture, we are going to start with the inductance of the transmission line. Thank you.